With every talk, I get closer. So the next talk, I'll be in the back of the church. Apparently, I need to wake you up more. The other ones are... Absolve me, my fathers. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. So, in this session, we're going to continue from where we left off by focusing on some of the difficulties that we have in prayer. And again, when I talk about prayer, I'm speaking specifically about the forms of prayer that we addressed in the first talk, recitative prayer, meditative prayer, or mental prayer, and contemplative prayer. These principles, of course, apply also to liturgical prayer, but we'll talk a little bit more about liturgical life in the next, in the third talk. Of course, when we talk about difficulties in prayer, one of the first things that will come up is time, right? Especially in our fast-paced society and the distractions that we have and all the obligations that we have with our children and with our work, and even in our service. Sometimes our service itself is spent with lots of activity that we don't give, and we don't find time for personal prayer. So let me just say and kind of share with you a nice story. It's a true story about a bishop who was, not in our church, but a bishop who was meeting with a group of priests and was speaking to them about how they should dedicate at least a half an hour of personal prayer to their day, to the priests. So one of the priests objected to the bishop and started to list off all of his responsibilities, and maybe some of us fathers we can relate. He started listing off all of his responsibilities from 6:30 in the morning till midnight. He said, from 6:30 in the morning, I do this, I start. And he listed off all of the things until midnight. He says, when am I going to find time for 30 minutes for personal prayer? So the bishop looked at him and he said, yes, you're right. You don't have enough time for 30 minutes of prayer. You need 1 hour of prayer. Because the more that we are suffocated by our activities, good activities, I'm not talking about bad activities, but the more we are suffocated by our activities, even our service, the more we need that activity, as we said in the beginning, to be what? Infused with divine life, infused with a supernatural grace. And that only comes when we dedicate time for prayer. And going back again to what I started with, prayer as the actualization of faith, hope, and love. Faith is an important aspect of this concept of time. Because if I believe that prayer is the most important activity that I can do, then I will dedicate time to it. Consequently, if I don't dedicate time to prayer, what I'm really saying is I really don't believe that prayer is the greatest activity. You understand what I'm saying? If I don't dedicate time for prayer, but I somehow find time for other activities, even service-oriented activities, then what I'm really saying is that I don't have faith that the outcome of my time dedicated to prayer is greater than the outcome of my time dedicated to whatever other activities they are. And I speak this to myself as a priest, because it's for us as priests, We are the most vulnerable to be suffocated by our activities. Good activities. I'm not talking about bad activities. Good activities. And nonetheless, if we believe, and if we look at all of the saintly fathers that many of us were speaking about, Abu Nebshoy Kamil and this beautiful generation of priests that came before us, we see that those who somehow were able to do so much in such little time were people of prayer, right? Look at someone like St. Pope Kyrillos, who really didn't do a lot of activities. He didn't, as a matter of fact, he was criticized because he didn't do a lot of activities. He didn't go that many places. He, morning liturgy, spent time with the people at the cathedral, evening vespers, a few days in the monastery, some days in Alexandria, some days in Cairo, at the praying services, and how much he accomplished because he was a man of prayer. So if you look, again, one of the spiritual writers, he says, if you look at yourself in the light of faith, you will understand that the more suppressed you are with activities, the more time you should dedicate to prayer. Right? This is, you know, in Christianity, everything's a paradox. Everything's a paradox. Everything's a contradiction. We find life in death. Right? We find joy in sorrow. We find light in the darkness. And he's giving us another paradox that we have to live by. The more you are suppressed, he says, with your activities, the more time you dedicate to prayer. Because what happens is when we dedicate more time to prayer, we accomplish more with less time. Our time becomes, again, infused with grace. And that grace is able to do more in the few hours that we have left than when it's just a purely human activity. Again, so the more suppressed you are with your activities, the more time you should dedicate to prayer. Otherwise, as we said before, you will be empty. You will have the impression that you are giving something, but this will only be an illusion. You cannot give what you do not have. Again, he says, in the light of faith, the most important activity in our day is prayer. It must take precedence over all other activities. Contact with God determines the value and the importance of our work. Contact with God determines the value and the importance of our work. So unless we are convinced that prayer is useful time, that prayer is more beneficial than any other activity, we will not find time for prayer. We will always find a reason to say, I have too much to do, I have too many activities, I have too many commitments. I understand that, of course, you know, sometimes people come to me, they're in medical school, they're doing residency, you know, and they're, you know, literally working, you know, 20 hours a day. They don't have the mental capacity afterwards to spend an hour, let's say, in prayer. But, you know, we have meals and we have snacks. And sometimes it's okay that we shift from having three big meals to maybe seven snacks. And maybe sometimes in our life, that's what we do. But with the guidance of our spiritual father, we can always find times for snacks. We can always find a few minutes a day to lift up our heart to God in prayer. I remember once with one of our senior priests, we were at a meeting all day and coming back in the car. And of course, the young priest, we were sitting in the back and talking and maybe gossiping about, you know, church stuff. And the Abuna, I won't mention his name, Annie, but one of our blessed fathers was sitting in the front, and he had his egbeya and he was doing all of his psalms. He was praying his psalms. And he took advantage of the time, even in the car, even with other people around, to have time for prayer. So we can always find time. If we can't dedicate an hour or half an hour in the morning when we're getting up and getting the kids ready, we can find one other one of our blessed priests, and again, who was one of the priests who served with one of the saintly fathers in Egypt. I asked him, like, as after I became a priest, like, how do you manage your time to say morning, evening prayers? And he told me, even in his own life, he says he does all of his prayer in one time of the day. So he dedicates 2 hours in the day for his prayers, whether it's the morning, evening psalms, or whatever his kanun is, whatever his rule is, plus his reading and maybe some preparation for a sermon. He, in those 2 hours, he puts his phone away, he shuts his door. That's his time with the Lord. In other words, what I want to say is sometimes when we don't find time in the morning or we don't find time at night, we say then we give up. If you can't, for some reason, do it in the morning or in the evening, do it in the middle of the day. But you have to have some time dedicated to prayer. And unless you have that faith that prayer is the most important work in your life, you will not find that time. The next difficulty that we find in prayer, which is really kind of, we spoke a lot about this last night at the meeting at St. Mary's, is dryness or aridity or spiritual desolations. So I think it was recorded. You can get the recording if you want it. This, we went into this subject in great depth last night. But the idea is that oftentimes in our prayers, we find our feelings are dry. I don't feel anything when I pray. I don't have any experience, any tangible experience of God. I don't see anything. I don't hear anything. I don't hear His voice. And so I feel that my prayer is worthless because I don't feel I made any contact with God. But as one of the spiritual fathers said, he said, you know, can you feel the blood circulating in your arteries? You can't. But the life is moving in our body, and we don't sense it. We can't hear it. We can't feel it. And that's why I said, you know, for the title for the second talk was from Philippians 2:13, it is God who works in us. And I tried to emphasize this point a lot in the beginning, that prayer is primarily agreeing to the invitation by God to meet with Him. Therefore, if He is the one who calls us to be with Him, then it is His work more than it is my work. In other words, to be with Him is our work. What we gain from being with Him is His work. So God is working in us when we give Him time in prayer, even if we don't feel anything, even if we don't see or hear anything. And this is what we call the mystical life, or as Abun and I were just talking about, the interior life. The interior life is a hidden life. There is something happening inside of us that we cannot tangibly feel, but it is a real movement of God in the soul. So, faith again is the measure by which we will enjoy prayer. Because, as I was saying last night, if I pray and I have emotional feelings in prayer, and then the next night I pray and have no emotional feelings in prayer, was God more present in the first day than in the second day? What do you think? Of course not. He was just as present the first day as He was in the second day. What's the difference? The difference was my emotions. Okay, good. Sometimes my emotions cooperate. Sometimes my emotions don't cooperate. Not a problem. But this is not the measure of my spiritual growth. This is not the measure of God's working in me. Because by faith, God is present. By faith, He is listening and loving me and working in me, not by emotions and not by feelings. Does God give us feelings sometimes? Of course He does. He gives us consolations, as we talked about last night. He gives us experiences of His presence. He gives us moments of grace. He gives us tears. He gives us joy in prayer. He gives us pleasure in worship. Sometimes. And then sometimes it's not there. And in those times, again, He is purifying us and cleansing us from our self-love and from our egos, which are hungering for pleasurable experiences. The ego desires pleasurable experiences, even spiritual pleasurable experiences. And yet, in order for God to bring us to a real experience of faith, He has to purify us from this desire, from this this reliance on sensible experiences. So again, another nice quote from one of the spiritual writers. He says, faith penetrates all recesses and finds God behind all concealments. Our Lord can hide Himself from all things except faith. God can be hidden from everything except by faith, as the one thing He can't hide from. He can hide from appearing in a vision. He can hide from letting us hear His voice. He can hide from all of these things, but He cannot hide from faith. So faith penetrates all the recesses and concealments. That's a beautiful thing to think about. And faith allows us to love God the same from one day to the next. So that, again, I don't give too much importance to how I felt yesterday versus how I feel today. I just acknowledge it and move on. One day I found great pleasure in prayer. The next day I didn't find as much pleasure in prayer. I'm not going to give so much importance to this. So faith allows me to love God the same yesterday and today and tomorrow, because I'm not relying on this as a measure of my love. And this kind of faith leads us to joy. One of the nice definitions I like very much of joy is love that is brought near. And the example is this. A mother loves her children who are scattered in different cities, let's say. Her grown-up children are in different cities. She loves them all. But her joy is complete when what? When they come home. Right? So love or joy is love that is brought near. So if by faith I'm able to love God the same today, tomorrow, and the next day, because I'm not relying on my emotions or my experiences, then I'm also going to live a life of joy, because that love is going to be always near. So that kind of faith in the presence of God in my life of prayer will allow me to have joy, a deep joy at all times. So the dryness that we have in prayer actually allows us, it affords us the opportunity to prove our love to God at a deeper level. And again, this is something we talked about last night, that when I am praying purely from faith and purely out of a love that is based on that faith and not because I have some consolations or some feelings, then this even pleases God more because he knows that it comes from pure love. It doesn't come from any selfish gain. Because when I pray and I have experiences or consolations, I'm not saying they're wrong. We said last night, God gives us these things for because he's good, the lover of mankind. But when I still am consistent in my life of prayer, even when I don't have those feelings or consolations, then God sees that I love him from a pure love. Not because I'm gaining anything at that moment other than self-offering. And this is what we want from prayer, is to realize that in prayer God is giving himself to me and he wants me to give myself to him. And just like in any relationship, self-offering has to be freed from self-interest. Right? In other words, my love to my wife should grow more and more as a self-offering, not as a self-interest. Not because of what she can do for me, but because of what I can do for her. Right? And so, God is giving himself to us. The gift of God is his self. He's giving us himself. And he wants us also to give him the gift of ourselves. And this can only be done when we allow to go through these periods sometimes of dryness and aridity and desolation so that we can make a true self-offering. So I hope that's kind of clear. If not, we can clarify it in the questions. Okay, the next difficulty that we often face in prayer is the inability to see progress, which leads us to discouragement. Somehow I think, well, I've been praying now for 2-3 years. I don't see much of a change. I don't see that I have changed much. And so then I become discouraged. What's the point? It's a waste of time. And just to give you a couple of quotes that I took from different monks and nuns that are giants in the spiritual life. One nun who's now in her 90s, she says, this might sound shocking, but she says, I never have the satisfaction of feeling that I prayed adequately, nor even the certainty that I have been faithful in prayer. And another monk, who is a spiritual father of a group of Orthodox monks, he says, I have the feeling that I have not yet begun to learn how to speak to God. In other words, even the giants, even St. Pope Kyrillos stood before God thinking that he's like still a beginner. Because once we touch eternity, right? Once we touch eternity, there's it's an infinite experience, an infinite growth. we will always feel like we're just starting. We're just learning how to pray. But again, one of the spiritual writers, he says, perhaps the saints became holy because they never made peace with the impossibility of seeing God in this life. The saints became holy because they never made peace, they never conceded that it's impossible to see God in this life. They kept going, even though the times they were tempted to be discouraged, even though at times they were tempted to think that their prayer was worthless, even though at times they were tempted to wonder whether their prayer was even effective, but they never made peace with that, those temptations. And so they became saints because they kept hungering and desiring and appearing again and again in prayer before the Lord. So as we said earlier in the question and answer last time, the more that I actually touch eternity, infinity, God, the more it leaves a desire that is still to be fulfilled. The more that I touch God, the more I desire him even more, and sometimes this is experienced as a kind of pain, a pain of separation. You know, when a mother gives birth to a child, her joy is mixed with pain because all of a sudden the fear of protecting and or losing this child or just wanting to shower this child with so much love and protection, right? There's a kind of mixed joy and fear, right? And there's this mixed feeling in us too whenever we touch an experience, a real experience of God, it leaves a kind of wound. And that wound sometimes gives the impression that I'm not doing something that I should be doing. How can I reach him? I can see him in the distance, but I can't yet grab him. I have an experience, but it's not the experience that I know I want. And that is, it's not that God is playing hide and seek from us, but he's kind of pulling us to higher and higher levels of desire and longing. And this is a good thing. And this is our sanctification that's happening in a hidden way that we don't even observe. Again, I think when you look at some of the giants in the spiritual life in our own church, they never made peace thinking that now I know how to pray. Now my prayer is okay. They always stood before God as beginners in the life of prayer. There's a nice quote from one of the saints. He says, cast aside worries, dismiss harmful judgments about yourself. God is in you and with you. What then do you fear? The anguished fear of having lost him is a sure and evident sign that he dwells within you. Your soul seeks and doesn't find, so it suffers, flounders, becomes delirious and exhausted, without ever calming itself down in its despondency. But here's the beautiful part. He says, but if for one single moment it could observe the satisfaction with which he observes your dissatisfaction of love, or your dissatisfied love, what joy. Let me explain that last part. If your soul could observe for a moment the satisfaction that God has in seeing how dissatisfied you are in your love towards him, what joy you would have if you saw how God was pleased with that. It's like this. It's like I asked my wife, do you know that I love you? She says, I know you love me very much. You always love me, and your love is always... I say to her, but you know what? I feel like I want to love you 100% more than what I love you now. Do you think that would make her happy? She'd be excited, right? You want to love me even more than you love me? Right? So I'm dissatisfied with how much I'm loving her, and she's satisfied because of my dissatisfaction. We're not happy because you're making us look bad. I have to send all these recordings to my wife. But do you understand the beauty of it? God is looking at you and he's, the fact that you are not happy about how much you're giving him and how much you're able to love him, that's proof of your love. If you didn't have that feeling, you wouldn't have love. You would be indifferent. You would be indifferent. So the fact that you want to love him more, but you feel like you can't, is the sign that you do love him, and that makes him very happy. So we have to be careful that we don't. Discouragement never comes from God. Contrition, yes. Sorrow for sins, yes. But discouragement never comes from God. Discouragement only comes from the evil one, or from our own ego that's not happy with its image of itself. I get discouraged because I look at myself and I say, you should be up here and you're still here. That's pride. It's my ego. And so I get discouraged. Discouragement is never from God. So whenever we feel discouraged, we have to be sure that this is not something that is God's voice in us. Another difficulty that we face is what I call the hindrance of our stature. The hindrance of our stature. And this applies to us as servants in the church, and especially to the clergy. I speak for myself, Father, sorry. What I mean is this. We come to prayer, and we stand before God, and I say, Lord, I'm a priest, and I have all these problems, and I have to do this, and I have to do that. And so I present myself as this very big, important person with lots of big, important problems. So the Lord says to me, you're a big, important person with big, important problems. Solve them. But what does he want me to do is he wants me to learn how to come to him as a child. Right? Abuna Metta al-Miskin has this beautiful example that he gives about this. I'm going to read you the quote. But let me read it first and then I'll say the example. He says, so beloved, no one can truly achieve this divine love except children. What I tell you is a spiritual law. It is impossible for a person to pray to God with all his heart, soul, and mind, and strength unless he becomes a child at heart. But the person who makes himself out to be a big man with big important responsibilities will find all of his duties and concerns assailing him during prayer. They'll start to bombard him during prayer. He refuses to be identified as a child and so undergoes the problem of a big man. But you should say to God, Lord, I am your little child so-and-so. Allow me into your presence with the face and heart of a child and receive this praise that flows from my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the example that he gave when he spoke about this, he said that he keeps a picture of himself, Abuna Metta, the giant, yani, the spiritual giant in our church, keeps a picture of himself when he was 7 years old or something. His name, I think, was Yusuf. And when he prays, Yusuf Iskander, he would have the picture in front of him and he'd say, Lord, you know who I am? I'm this kid. I'm this child. That's who I am. Deal with me like this child. But if I come with all of my problems and all my the mature things that I have to present to God, and he says to me, come to me as a child, and I will overflow my paternal care and care for you. But if you make yourself out to be a big person with big important responsibilities, then we're going to find all those big problems attacking us in prayer. So we have to learn in prayer to humble ourselves as children. Doesn't matter the black that I'm wearing. Doesn't matter the size of my amma. It doesn't matter what class you're teaching in Sunday school. In front of God, we all are children. That's why I said in the beginning, the most important thing that we gain of knowledge in prayer about God is that he is what? Anybody remember? Our Father. That's the most important thing we gain in a life of prayer, that deepening knowledge and experience of the fatherhood of God. Abba, Father. Okay, the next, let's see, is this my last one? No, two more, sorry. Are we okay in time? Okay. Distractions. And this is one, of course, that we all face. All of us are faced with distractions, especially at the time of prayer. Whether you come to stand at church in the liturgy, or you stand in your home in front of your icon corner, or wherever you pray, or you open your Bible, all of a sudden you find thoughts coming from every direction. And of course, on top of the thoughts, now we have the notifications on our phone. Right? Text message, Facebook Messenger, all of these things coming, and then we say, look, should I check it now? It might be important. So distractions. Of course, we have to do a simple exercise, but without injury. Let me say it that way, without injury. The simple exercise is this. When I find myself distracted, I calmly and patiently with myself, without hating myself, I say, oh, I'm distracted. Let me focus again on the liturgy. Let me focus again on the text. Let me focus again on my psalm. And then I find myself distracted again. Oh, and I bring myself back. I calmly bring myself back every time sometimes I might go a minute. Sometimes when I'm driving, this is me, so you want to drive around me. Sometimes when I'm driving, I'm like, I don't even remember driving the last 15 minutes. Like, I remember I was there like 15, and then 15, and not because I'm a sawah or anything, but because I'm just so distracted. I'm like, did I even pay attention to the road? I don't even remember driving. So sometimes we find we've been distracted for 10 minutes and we didn't even know it. But again, the problem that we usually have is that as soon as we get angry with ourselves because I've been distracted, I can't focus, and then I start to get discouraged, and I start to say it's worthless, why am I even here? Especially mothers who have to care for their kids when they come to the church, and their kids are making noise or a distraction to them, they say, well, no, why should I even come to the liturgy? What's the purpose? I can't even focus on the liturgy. We have to be calm about these distractions, because these are, the devil, his goal is not the distraction. His goal is the discouragement and the despair that comes after. That's his goal. Because there's no damage done in the distraction. If we are making a simple effort to be aware of our distractions and to re-engage our mind and our heart in prayer. And what we're left with after we make that simple effort is that we acknowledge the poverty of spirit that we are. That we are poor in spirit, right? I say, Lord, you see how wretched I am. You see that I don't even have the mind and the heart to worship you with full attention. Have mercy on me, right? What does it mean to be poor in spirit? We talked a little bit about this last night too. If I come to my prayer life, if I come to worship, and I have certain virtues and strengths that I built up, then I'm rich in spirit. I'm not poor in spirit. So a person who is poor in spirit doesn't see that they have achieved anything. That's not how God sees us, but that's how we see ourselves. A person is poor in spirit, even though God has given him, but he still says, my hands are empty. I didn't receive yet. I'm going to wait for some more. Give me some change. But as soon as one of the spiritual fathers that we talked about last night, as soon as I feel like I receive something and I walk away from the corner begging, then at that moment I cease to be a beggar. I became a rich person, even for a moment. But the Lord says, what? Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So the poor in spirit are the ones who are poor in their prayer. The ones who feel like they have nothing to offer, that their prayer is weak, that their prayer is dry, that their prayer is full of distractions. Blessed are you. Blessed are you to be in this category. Blessed am I to be in this category. If I stand before God and say, Lord, you see, I have nothing. I have no virtue. I have no virtue in prayer. Let me again read what one of the, this 90-year-old nun, she's older now, what she said. She said, distractions are my unfailing companions at prayer. Distractions are my unfailing companions at prayer. But I have learned that prayer doesn't go on in the head, in the brain box, but in the secret heart that is choosing to pray and to remain in prayer no matter what it feels, no matter what it feels like or seems like to me. So, she said, I realize that prayer is not so much what my mind is able to process, but in the desire of the heart and the will that wants to be there. the desire and the will to be there. That's where prayer takes place. Then she says, I am totally convinced that our God, the God we see in Jesus, is all love, all compassion, and what is more is all gift, is always offering God's own self as our perfect fulfillment. I believe through Christ that we were made for this and that it is divine love's passion to bring it to perfect fulfillment in us. So when I set myself to pray, I am basing myself on this faith, and I refuse to let it go. I just take it for granted that because God is the God of Jesus, all love, who fulfills every promise, this work of love is going on, purifying and gradually transforming me. What I actually experience on my conscious level is quite unimportant. In fact, I experience nothing except my poor, distracted self. So prayer takes place at a deeper place. And as long as you have the will and the desire to be there in prayer, God is working in you. Don't judge your prayer by your distracted mind. But increase your desire, increase the will to remain in prayer. And the final one is guilt. Guilt that comes from our personal sins, which usually come to attack us as soon as we do any sort of prayer. As soon as we stand in prayer at church or in our rooms, all of a sudden, all of the guilt of what we have done, all of the passions that we're struggling against, all of the things that I committed I wasn't going to do and I did, they all come and attack me. St. John Chrysostom, he has a beautiful saying. He says, when a soldier in battle is wounded and gives ground a little, no one is so unreasonable or so ill-versed in military matters as to believe that such behavior is criminal. In other words, when somebody in battle is hit and they back out, they move the lines back, no one is going to say that what they did is criminal, is wrong. Only those who are invulnerable, in other words, only those who are protected behind the walls who are not in the battle and who do not fight, only they are the ones who never get injured. In other words, the fact that you are struggling with sin, the fact that you are hit by sin, is proof that you are on the battlefield. And if you're on the battlefield and you get hit, then you are a soldier. The ones who are hiding behind the walls are the ones who don't want to be in the battle. And maybe that's why we see them as not being hit by sin. Again, St. John Chrysostom says, do not ever despair. I will say this every time I address you, he says to his people, in all my conversations. Our salvation has two mortal enemies, presumption while innocent and despair after a fall. The second is more terrible. There are two enemies. The second one is the worst, he says, which is despair after a fall. That's more dangerous than presumption while innocent, that is, presuming God's action towards us. Despair after a fall is a more dangerous thing to fall into, he says. And what's beautiful is that there's St. Augustine, he uses the expression happy fault. Have you ever heard of that expression, happy fault? So one of his studies, I don't know. He regarding sin, he says, oh, happy fault. Why is it a happy fault? He says sin can be turned into something beautiful. Our sin in the garden, what was the result of that? Christ came to us. And the fathers tell us that what we gained after the incarnation is better than if the incarnation never took place. So it's a happy fault. And in the same way, our sins can, because God is good and powerful and he wills to transform evil into good, God can use our sins to good. How? Very simply. I sin. I humble myself before God. I become more humble. And that humility is more important to God than the righteousness of overcoming that sin. Because that humility will allow me to stand before God as poor in spirit. That humility will allow me not to judge my brother. That humility will allow me to be meek and kind to others because I myself am a wounded sinner. But if I have victory in this sin that I'm struggling against, Maybe I will suffer from self-righteousness. And there's another quote here I wanted to read about that. St. Gregory of Nyssa. St. Gregory of Nyssa says, "A cartload of good works drawn by pride leads to hell." You know, like a, you can call it a U-Haul. A U-Haul of good works drawn by pulled by pride leads to hell. Whereas a U-Haul or a cartload of sins drawn by humility leads to paradise. So this is from the fathers. Our sins can be transformed into something beautiful. At a minimum, all of our sins can be transformed into humility. And that humility can become something more beautiful than the righteousness that we wish to receive from that, from overcoming that sin. And then the final thing is that our misery, our poverty as sinners, makes us more lovable and attracted by the mercy of God. One of the fathers says, his vocation, the vocation of Christ, his calling, his reason for coming into the world is to be the Savior. And he says, each time we offer him a fault to be forgiven, we offer him the title of Savior. Every time we go to him and say, Lord, forgive me, I have fallen again, then I grant him the title of Savior. And it's a title that he loves. So we should never despair, when we should never let guilt prevent us from approaching God in prayer. Because God will use our sins and transform them into something beautiful if we go to him as children and say, Lord, I don't have any good works, I don't have any virtues, but here's what I have. I have a lot of sins. What can you do with these? He says, I will take that and I will give you something in return very beautiful. That's his vocation. That's why he came. He didn't come for the righteous, he said, but for the sinners, you and me. Glory be to God forever. Amen. Any questions?
So I'm going to deflect it to you. the question was, if God already has a plan for us and knows what our lives will be, what is the purpose of prayer and asking for things? Or so I'm just curious to see how you might answer that, and sort of appropriate with what we're talking about.
A very simple question. Yeah. Well, as I said in the beginning, what should be our primary? Behind that question is, what can I get from prayer? What can I really get from prayer? And if I can't really get something from prayer, then is it really worth it? But the greatest thing that we get in prayer is God himself. That's why our Lord Jesus, when he gave the example, which father, if his son asks him for bread, will give him what? A stone. But how much more your Heavenly Father if we ask for the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit. So he teaches us what we should ask for in prayer. The Holy Spirit. Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Right? Now, definitely there is a benefit in prayer. Can I pinpoint exactly how it works? I can't. It's a mystery. But definitely all of the saints, in their experience, they say prayer moves God's hand. Pope Rose had that famous saying, the prayer moves the, I think in Arabic you probably know it better, the hand of him who moves the world. So definitely, and the psalm says, in one of the psalms it says that God's ear is bent to his righteous, or to his, right? I forget the exact expression. To the prayer of the righteous, his head is bent, his ear is listening, right? And St. Paul says, the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So there is benefit in prayer. There is change that happens in prayer. How does that fit in? God foresees that prayer in eternity, and he includes it in his providence. It's a mystery. I can't, maybe one of the fathers can describe it better, but what can we receive in prayer primarily? I want God himself. I want God himself. And I know if I have God, everything else is, then I have everything else. So definitely prayer benefits. We should ask as children, we should ask for our daily bread. We should ask for those things. We should ask for the virtues. We should ask for the spirit of forgiveness and so on. But we should primarily, I think, you know, again, adhere, you know, respond to the invitation of our Lord to be with him, because he wants to do something in us. He wants to give us something very beautiful. But trust, again, versus clarity. You know, we talked about this last night. Trust versus clarity. Jesus says to us, pray. Pray always. Right? Ask, seek, knock. So much of his homilies, his sermons, his public life was about prayer. Watch, pray. If he says so, then there is a benefit. How can I exactly measure how, when I say this, how does he react and how does it fit in with his providence, from his foreknowledge, from his will? He incorporates it, but he tells us the benefit of prayer. He tells us that we should pray, or we should keep seeking and knocking, that there is a benefit, that there is something beautiful that happens in prayer. I wish one of the fathers maybe can expand on this question.
I think that it changes us to match his will more than it changes his will to match our will. Because I think the question is, sometimes we are asking, if we prayed, his will change to match our request. And I think it's the opposite, what's happening.
Thank you. Any other questions?
My question is about really the content of prayer. You know, you spoke about wanting to be in the presence of God, and maybe the prayer is really more about wanting God. But we've grown up with this approach to prayer of having this laundry list that we're like, hey, God, I want this, please protect my kids, please do this. And so how do we kind of change our approach to prayer and at the same time kind of teach that approach to our kids? So it's not just kind of going through this laundry list of please do this, please do that.
Yeah. Were you here for the first talk? Okay. So when I talked about like the three forms of prayer, you know, like the prayer books of the church, like the Egbe, as kind of being the alphabet by which we learn the language of prayer and how to speak to God in his language, his inspired language. And then meditative prayer through reading, and contemplative prayer through silence and recollection. But I want to say something about praying to God in our own words. I believe it's important. Not because of the list of what we ask for, but because, like, as a father, and I know many of you are parents, as a father, what joy when my son now is in college, but when my son and my daughter were younger and they would sit on my lap and they would say, Daddy, I want this and I want that. And I want this, and I want that. And I say, okay, give me a hug, give me a kiss, give me a kiss. And then what else do you want? And I just smothering them with love because of how this intimacy. Yeah, I think God wants us to open up our hearts to him as children and speak to him of what's in our hearts. And I think the personal prayer is when we do that. Because one of a Catholic priest that I met in Orange County, he's like in his late 80s now. He spent a lot of his life directing other priests that were in the Catholic Church that went through problems, like in their ministry. So I had a nice talk with him once, and we were talking about prayer. And he said something very beautiful. I never thought about it. I wonder what the fathers think of this. He said, you know, in church, of course he's speaking about the Catholic Church, but in the same thing in the Orthodox Church, our public liturgical worship is ritualistic, right? We have rites, we have tux, right, and structure, times, all of these things are certain ways that we stand or bow or kneel or whatever it is that we do. And he says, when we go from liturgical prayer to personal prayer, we should move from ritualistic to less ritualistic. Meaning, doesn't mean that ritualistic prayer doesn't have intimacy. It does. Of course, it's worship and it praises God, it glorifies Him. But there is something to be said about being able, in my personal prayer, to have a kind of friendship with God, an intimacy with Him, where I don't have to worry so much about what I say. Right? What I say is informed by the church. It's informed by what I learned in the prayers of the church, Our Father, the Psalms, and so on. It's informed. Yeah, the alphabet is there. But now I want to just open my heart to Him. And I think that this is a beautiful way that we pray. And it could be something as simple as speaking to the Lord and saying, Lord Jesus, today I was very sad. It's very sad. This happened to me earlier today. And it hurt my feelings. Help me. I have no one but you. And share with Him something that happened to you today. This priest that he told me, he says that when he drives, maybe you like this, maybe you don't like this. I thought it was very beautiful. He says sometimes when he drives, he pictures the Lord Jesus in the passenger seat and he talks to Him. And he says, this is the freedom that we have as children of God. This is the dignity that we have as children of God, that we can pray anywhere, anytime, in any way, even in our thoughts and in our hearts without words. That's our privilege as children of God. We have that right. Just like my child has a right to come and jump in my arms and as we saw Abuna Samuel today, as the girls kept coming and hugging him during while he was trying to eat, and it's beautiful. Right? I imagine that our Lord very much loves that we do that with Him. So I don't think it's wrong to teach our kids to pray from their heart, the things that are, that's their language. Jesus, help mommy and daddy, right? Teaching them that Jesus is your friend. I mean, He said that to us, I no longer do I call you servants, but what? Friends. Okay, I'm going to take advantage of that privilege I have. Does that mean He's not Lord and Master? No, He is Lord and Master. He's both. I don't know if I answer. Again, I wish the fathers have any. And how about was this? Your servants.
Abuna Otsak mentioned that when we don't have time, we can even pray when we're in the car or whatever. I think that when we have an important meeting or an important phone call or something, we give full attention to it. So isn't this when we pray in the car or at work or whatever, isn't this a little bit disrespectful? Or I understand it's better than nothing, but I feel like this is not full respect to God.
Well, I think what I wanted to say was, I didn't say that our prayer can be only in the car. We move from meals to snacks, meaning, maybe you talk about the example I gave of Abuna when he was praying in the car. Again, I would say for sure this Abuna prays at home, and he prays in his corner where nobody sees. But that doesn't mean that he also can't pray in the car. Right? It's better, why not, in the car instead of talking about useless things, to pray. So I don't say that prayer should only be reduced to when we have time in the car, just put the egbe on the radio or on the CD, and that's my prayer. I'm saying that if for some reason, for example, I have a college student who is used to praying the morning and the evening and so on, and he comes to the church and he does tazbaha, and all of a sudden he finds himself in residence in medical school, and he's 20 hours a day out of the, he's not going to find the time to do these things. So rather than tell him, khalas, yani, you're hopeless, you're useless, your medical degree is going to take you to hell, no, I encourage him to grab 2 minutes while you're in between shifts and go somewhere and lift your heart to God. This is my opinion. Again, it doesn't mean for those of us who have the ability, that, and that's why I started with time. If we see by faith that prayer is the most important activity, we will find the time. But for whatever circumstances, a mother who didn't sleep all night because her kids were throwing up and whatever, then we move from meals to snacks. That's the point I wanted to make.
Abuna. So I've been talking with other college students, and a lot of them say that, like, oh, I like Elhan, I don't like the Agbeya, or I like Tisbehat, and I don't like Elhan. Like, they say that, like, one time is where they really feel prayer, they really feel the connection to God. So then they're saying, like, if I only feel prayer and I only feel connection towards God during Elhan, why should I come to Tisbehat? Why should I come to Asheya when I'm not feeling it? I'm just, like, reciting.
I think it's a good, very good question. I think if we're really humble, and if we really are beggars, then we will be looking for food everywhere. And if the church tells us this will nourish you, and this will nourish you, and this will nourish you, you will go here and here and there, even if you enjoy this one more. Like when you're, again, using the example of a parent with their children, if you ask your child who's 6 years old, Habibi, what would you like to eat today? I have peas, and I have chocolates. Chocolate? Okay, this is what you like. Let me give you chocolate. What would you like for dinner? Peas or chocolate? Chocolate, of course. Right? The idea is that if I really humble myself and become a child before God, then I will also entrust myself to his church, which is feeding us from her motherly love, care, in all of these ways. It doesn't mean maybe I'm not good at tisbaha. Okay, you don't have to be like perfect in tisbaha. You don't have to, it's not required that you attend tisbaha every time. But well, let me give you another avenue. So that's the first point, is that our humility will allow us to, I think, eat from everywhere. And this also applies to things like sermons. You know, if you come to the church and you say, oh, you know, this Abuna is a great speaker, I'm going to go, but this Abuna, I don't get much from him, I'm not going to go. Then you're not poor in spirit, you're rich. You're rich, you don't need to hear from this Abuna. But if you are really hungry, you will go to the church and you will say, Lord, give me something. I'm very hungry. Give me something. And he will give you that something from any mouth, because you're hungry. Not because of Abuna. One of the spiritual fathers, he said something very beautiful about this. He said, as a priest, for example, he says, as a priest, for some people, I will just be the celebrant of the sacraments. That's all they will take from me. They come and Abuna is praying the liturgy, we take communion, maybe I go to confession, that's it. For some, he says, I will be a spiritual father. Not only will they come and take the sacraments from the hands of Abuna, but they will entrust from his guidance their spiritual life. And then he said, for some people, I will be a prophet. Prophet. Now, he wasn't speaking out of pride. On the contrary, what he's saying is it has nothing to do with Abuna. It has to do with you. Your faith and your poverty of spirit, your hunger, will determine what God's going to give you. If all of you see from Abuna is that, bisalli al-Qudas, kwayis, that's what he's good for, نروح ناخد نتناول وخلاص. And if you have more faith in God, not in Abuna, but you have more faith in God through his priest, that he will direct your life, then he will be a spiritual father to you. And if you have even more faith than that in God through the church, through the priesthood of the church, then Abuna will be a prophet. He will, without Abuna even knowing it, he will be a prophet for you because of your faith. Right? And the same way with hymns, with prayers, if we come with that spirit, God will feed us. Having said that, I'll just make one other kind of point that complements that. And I heard a nice recording of Amba Gregorius talking about, Amba Athanasius of Beni Suif, the late Amba Athanasius of Beni Suif, speaking about his memories with Pope Kyrillos. And somebody asked him, what was Pope Kyrillos like as a spiritual guide? And he personally, like, we know what he was like as a public figure and his miracles, but when somebody sat with him, especially when he was a Abuna Mina in Old Cairo, and people used to take confessions of the college students and so on, what was he like? How did he encourage people in the spiritual life? And he said something very beautiful. He said he knew that not everybody had the same path to God. some we have different paths to God through the church. But what he meant by that was this. He said, if he found somebody who really benefited and loved, let's say, to pray the Igbaya, he would encourage him to do more of the Igbaya. If he found somebody that loved to pray the Jesus Prayer, he would encourage him to pray the Jesus Prayer more. If he found somebody who loved to read the Bible, he would tell him to go deeper in his reading of the Bible. In other words, he would guide the person in the way that he felt God was attracting that person to the life of grace, whether it was through... That doesn't mean that the person who was praying the Jesus Prayer didn't pray the Igbaya, but perhaps there's more emphasis in one discipline. I think that's wise. Again, I think that that's wise. We don't just give like a blanket kind of cookie cutter recipe for everybody. That's the whole purpose of guiding people in the spiritual life, is to help them discover how God is attracting them in that unique relationship, and to guide them in that, to be with them in that relationship between them and God. It's not a relationship between me and the person. It's I'm journeying with that person in their relationship with God. So I think put those two principles together and you find a balance. One more question.
As a mother, and I want to ask a question about distractions. I have two teenage and then I have two toddlers. Mm-hmm. So standing at night and praying as a family, as one unit, is difficult with the toddlers. Mm. So do I take the toddlers and my husband takes the teens, or vice versa, to stop those distractions, especially to teach the teens? Or should we still be one family and pray together? I mean, in the morning, everybody has their own prayers at their own time. But at night, it's when we come together.
I heard a nice story from a very holy Romanian monk who now, he departed. And he was talking about his experience growing up in Romania. And he was one of, I think, 7 or 8 children. And so he talked about how his mother would take them to church, all 7 or 8 of them. And of course, imagine a young mother, by herself taking 8 children, young children to the church, and trying to stand for 3-4 hours of liturgy, right? So the kids would complain and say, my feet hurt. And what he remembered, and now speaking as an old man, he remembered this from when he was a child. He said, my mother would turn to us and say, my son, don't you know that your sore feet is your prayer to God? Your sore feet is your prayer to God, right? So I think we can take that principle and apply it in your family. Let's say, this is just an example. Maybe you sit with the Bun and hash it out more, but you should keep the time that you pray together as a family reasonable, right? Yani, Basili, not Gregory, yani, or that's Basili. Right? Yani, keep it 10 minutes. 10 minutes. 10 minutes, you can get through most of one of the hours of the Igbaya and have some, maybe a few words. Yeah, the kids speak in their own words. What I used to do sometimes with my kids when they were younger, when they really couldn't follow the Igbaya, the words yet, is they would take turns, and we have like a candle in front of the icons, and okay, tonight whose turn is it to blow out the candle? Oh, it's Matthew's turn? Okay, so they're excited just to wait till we're done, yani, saying the prayers, and they're standing there, and, and then, okay, and then they get excited, they get to blow out the candle. Why? Especially because the sisters, she doesn't get to do it. It's my turn today, right? And vice versa. So I think be creative in how you you bring them into prayer, but don't force. Don't make prayer a negative experience for them. Let the toddlers pray in their own way. Even if they're sitting on the floor playing, it's okay. That's their prayer. They're praying in front of the icon in their way. And then encourage the older ones and then maybe at some point, you also have your prayer apart from the family, which you can go deeper, you and your husband. So that's just my advice. I mean, again, maybe, and you sit with your spiritual father and come up with a solution. But I think if you kind of find that balance, it'll It'll work.